welcome to another edition of Currently in Quincy. I'm Joe Catalano, and on today's program, we will learn about an effort to call more attention to violence against healthcare workers, plus an event that's coming up soon in Braintree to highlight that effort. First, though, we check out the weather and the news for you this morning. Currently in Quincy, some sunshine with some clouds out there. It's 72 degrees right now. We'll have temperatures climbing into the mid-70s with a mix of sun and clouds this afternoon. Clouds will increase this evening, and temperatures will drop off tonight into the lower 60s. Looks like today is going to be the pick of the week because after this, chance for showers most of the rest of this week, including tomorrow with the high around 70, some spotty showers, still a shower possible Wednesday, a lot of clouds, still a risk of a shower even on Thursday with a high right around 70. But again, partly sunny, 72 in Quincy right now. In the news today, Quincy City Council will meet tonight to finalize next year's city budget and to consider a proposal for a large new development in Quincy Center. Officials will debate Mayor Thomas Koch's request to borrow $61 million to make some major infrastructure improvements in Quincy Center and also to create a new department to oversee maintenance of Quincy Center. The mayor says the costs of maintaining the new developments downtown would be paid for from revenue generated by new developments within that district.
You know, the Hancock Adams Common was a major investment that needs to be maintained. There's going to be new public areas. There's going to be garages. All those things need to be maintained at a level, and you need to have it, you know, people focused on it. So, you know, that was my idea of the division. Now it's, you know, my understanding that many of the councils have a problem with that, so I'm looking at making some changes in how we bake it. That some of the councils don't seem to have trouble with the dollars. It's how it's baked into the budget, and you know, as Councilor Palmucci articulated, that he felt it was showing favoritism of a district over other neighborhoods, and I looked at it really the other way, not favoritism, but showing the public that were paying for this stuff out of the downtown, you know. But if they want to put it in a different category, but we accomplished the same thing, I'm fine with that.
Some city councilors did object to creating a separate department just for Quincy Center, saying it was unfair to other sections of the city. Tonight is the last council meeting before summer break. Officials will reconvene after Labor Day. Quincy restaurants with outdoor patios can now use them year-round. The Board of License Commissioners last week voted unanimously to allow the year-round patio use. It's in an effort to help local businesses grow their customer base. The board's chairwoman and city clerk, Nicole Crispo, felt that the regulations allowing outdoor patios from Patriots Day to Columbus Day was too restrictive.
The winters are long. The spring was so wet that I hope that, you know, we could extend the time that that the owners could use their patios later in the season.
Okay.
And so sometimes we get, you know, some beautiful weather in October and November.
Yep.
So I brought that forward to the board.
Crispo says there was some resistance from a small number of people who worried about intrusive noise from the patios, but she says all the regulations regarding noise will remain in place and that there have been no complaints about patios for the past 2 years. Police say they've shut down a pretty major drug distribution operation that was based out of Quincy and Hyde Park. After a three-month investigation, officers executed search warrants at a home at 16 Hall Place in West Quincy and on Neponset Valley Parkway in Hyde Park last week. Police seized cocaine, fentanyl, and almost $9,000 in cash. Louris Feliz from Quincy and Nelson LaCourte Lanayers of Boston were both arrested and charged with drug trafficking. Feliz is being held on $100,000 bail, and LaCourte Lanayers was held without bail because police say he stole another person's identity. National Grid was making some repairs after a school bus struck a utility pole in Quincy this morning. This happened on Quincy Avenue right near East Howard Street in Quincy Point just before 9:30 this morning. As you can see, they're taking down some power lines and knocking out electricity in the area. Police say the Weymouth school bus driver was the only person on board the bus and escaped safely. Police were on scene directing traffic around the accident scene. The cause of the crash is still under investigation. 13 South Shore residents were recently inducted into Interfaith Social Services of Quincy's Matt Lang Hall of Fame. The volunteers were honored at a volunteer appreciation night at the Quincy Lodge of Elks. Signet Electronic Systems was also honored at that event for their commitment to volunteerism. The honorees include Braintree resident Terrell Harris, Diane Mulkern, and Emily Ryan from Milton, Kelly Clasby of Plimpton, and Robin Anderson, Pamela Baker, Kathy and Ron Collins, Teresa Kerrigan, Rainey O'Gara Pratt, Isabella Oliveri, Angela Ryan, and Robert Slack, all of Quincy. Now that you're up to date with weather and news, let's check out our programming lineup for you for later on today here on Quincy Access Television. And it'll start with a replay of this program currently in Quincy at 5 o'clock. After that at 6, highlights from this year's Quincy Senior Olympics. Eye on Quincy is live tonight at 7 on Channel 8. At 8 o'clock, this year's North Quincy High School graduation ceremony. And an At the Library concert series tonight at 10 featuring Haley Hewitt. Check out Channel 9 every day. Learn about Quincy City Department's different committee activities. Starts at 5:30 with Quincy in Focus. And then at 6 o'clock, the City Council meeting is live from City Hall. Starts with the Finance Committee, some public hearings, and then the full Council meeting at 7:30. If you'd like to get a complete program schedule, head on over to our website, qatv.org, and just click on Program Schedule. Don't forget, too, you can always like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter. Don't forget, too, our weekly ad in the Quincy Sun. Coming up, we'll take a look at a few of the current events and activities that are being shown on our electronic bulletin board on Channel 8. So please stay tuned. We're back with you in just 1 minute. Welcome back. Here is a look at some of the current events and activities we're featuring right now on our electronic bulletin board on Channel 8 for your information. Saturdays in the Park will be held at Safford Park on Beale Street in Wollaston. These start up on June 29th and will run right through August 3rd from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. They are free events. They'll feature live entertainment, food, and a craft beer garden, family fun, and a whole lot more. The website to learn all about them, wollastonhill.com. A fundraiser to benefit the This Star Won't Go Out organization is scheduled for June 30th from 6 to 9 p.m. at Alba's Restaurant in Quincy Center. There'll be a raffle, silent auction, and a wine poll as part of the celebration. Visit shineunderthestars.com to learn all about the event and the organization founded in memory of 16-year-old Esther Earle. Quincy Farmers Market opens for its 37th season this coming Friday up at Pageant Fields. The market will be held on Fridays from 11:30 to 5 right through November. The website, quincyfarmersmarket.com. And the annual Squantum Road Race is coming up on June 29th at 9:30 at the Squantum Community Center. Kids under 10 can participate for free, and the race is sponsored by State Representative Bruce Ayers. If you have an event or an activity you'd like to promote, visit our website, qatv.org. Just download a bulletin board request form, fill it out, and send it in. We'll get your message up here on Channel 8, too. Coming up, we will learn about an effort underway to call more attention to the issue of violence against healthcare workers. That's next. Welcome back. There is an event coming up later on this month, actually, over in Braintree to focus on the issue of violence against healthcare workers. And there's actually a nonprofit organization called Stop Healthcare Violence. Sheila Wilson from that group is here to tell us about the organization, about this event, and about why this is an issue. So, Sheila, welcome. Thanks for coming over.
Thank you.
Pleasure to have you. When you said, I want to have a fair about the issue of violence against healthcare workers, I'm sure a lot of folks are saying, is that an issue? So is that an issue, Sheila?
Yes, it's a huge issue.
Yeah.
The very first time I was ever assaulted, I was a medical assistant, and that was way back in 1978. Mm. And that was kind of a long time ago.
Yes.
But it really is starting to develop a lot more. 70% to 80% of your healthcare workers get assaulted. And if you stop and think about that, and when I talk about healthcare workers, I'm talking about x-ray techs, medical assistants, your ultrasound people, your mammographers, all of these people, a lot of them work by themselves. But 70% to 80%, I mean really, does 70% to 80% of your employees here get assaulted?
Certainly not.
No.
Yeah.
And not only get punched, pinched, spit on, urine thrown at us, feces thrown around, it's not nice.
Mm-hmm.
We've had nurses stabbed. We've had nurses pushed to the ground. They've had black eyes. They've had shoulder injuries. And it goes on and on.
Now, so when you say we, you yourself are a nurse for many, many years, right?
I've been a nurse for over 40 years.
Okay.
And I've worked... I've had a fabulous career.
Yeah.
I truly have. The last 17 years in the emergency room was just about the time that you get your calling to leave that area.
Hmm.
As you get older, you don't have the quickness, the flexibility to duck and to run and do what you have to do now in this stage of life.
It sounds like you're
patients describing
a battle zone almost.
It is almost a battle zone.
Really?
And it gets to the point where, you know, even if you're unionized or you do anything and you have to fight for everything. We had to have, we decided to have workplace violence committee meetings and with administration and nurses trying to work together. Well, we didn't even have a security guard at that time. I'm going back a few years. And we needed a security guard. Just somebody that could patrol going up and down to make sure that the patients were okay or somebody's getting agitated and we, the nurses, don't see that or the medical assistants. But we didn't have that either.
Mm-hmm.
We had to call them. So if you have a hospital that only has 3 or 4 security guards, they don't have enough time to get to the emergency room when you're getting beaten up. So we finally really did a program and we got the security guard. But only one security guard
okay.
in the emergency room.
Can I ask where?
What hospital?
Mm.
Oh, that's a local hospital here in Dorchester.
Okay, all right.
And but we were really trying to work together, and that's really the secret of trying to stop a lot of this violence, to get administration and the nurses, medical assistants, all of us to work together. And where is the problem? What is the solution?
And you started this effort over 10 years ago.
Well, it was 2008, yes.
Yeah, this is not new.
It's not new. And in 2010, we all thought that Governor Deval Patrick was signing it into felony.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a misdemeanor. And we were happy that something was being done.
Yeah.
But a misdemeanor is like a slap in the hand.
So obviously there are, already laws for assault and battery, but
mm-hmm.
you're calling specifically for healthcare workers.
Yes.
Right? Yeah.
Yes, we need to be protected by the legal system, but we also need to be protected. We need to be safe in the environment.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's a law that we should be safe in the environment.
Yeah, and you've tried that effort, right, on the state level, unsuccessfully, unfortunately.
Yes,
yeah.
we've been doing this for a long time.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of people trying to get it to change because 34 other states have it as a felony.
Oh, they do? Okay.
They do. And so if you assault a healthcare worker. And the other thing on these bills while we're talking
yeah.
about it, Senate Bill 838 and a House Bill of 1578. It's not just healthcare workers for us, but it's also the EMS.
Mm-hmm.
the EMS, when they come into us, the paramedics, the medical assist technicians, if they're still there while they're writing their reports, they're the ones that help us.
I see.
They're first on the scene.
Okay.
And they don't take a second to stop and think.
Right.
And part of this law is that in their law, it's like treating and transporting. Well, once they transport and we have them, well, then they're supposed to go. But because they are who they are, they're right there.
And they know there could be a problem, so they hang around if they have the time to make sure things are okay.
EMS, yeah. Without the EMS, every city would be a disaster.
Yeah. This, it sounds to me like, is a very underreported issue. Is that true, would you say?
Well, you kind of hit the nail on the head,
okay.
Yes. Because as healthcare workers, we just take it as kind of like part of the job.
Yeah.
And we make excuses for the patients.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of truly doing what would be best and holding these folks accountable, because it's not so much like learning a lesson, but they can't just come in and assault us and think it's okay. But they do, because nothing ever happens to them.
And is it because they're under the influence of something, or because of the illness that they're there for, or is it because of something else?
Well, there has always been a range. You know, like a lot of people say, well, you know, it's has to be a drunk guy that came and hit
right.
you, or a drunk woman. No, oh, that's the drug addict.
Right.
It's not.
Okay.
It's not just them. I had the experience. I worked in three different detoxes.
Mm-hmm.
I was never assaulted.
Mm-hmm.
I was always respected.
Mm-hmm.
And so I can't say, oh, yeah, it's only the drunk. So when they walk in, we'll just, you know, put them in a room and tie them
let
up
them
or something.
Dry out or something, yeah.
Yeah, but people are mean.
Mm-hmm.
People have a lot of stress, and we need to recognize that a little bit more. Now, yeah, your drug addicts, they will attack because they're not getting their medicines.
Mm-hmm.
Or if we start giving Narcan IV, which I don't know if everybody will know, but that stops their high, and of course they get angry, plus the bodily functions and everything else. So, I mean, and it's a lot of confusion and everything. They'll come right at you, but you're prepared for that.
Yeah.
It's the people that you just don't think that they're going to hurt you.
Right.
The
yeah.
Alzheimer patient, the demented patient, the patient with low blood sugar, the patient that has seizures, we know how to treat those.
Sure.
And you don't go in there by yourself. You don't walk out with your back to the patient when you're a little easy,
mm-hmm,
you know,
mm-hmm.
uneasy.
Yeah.
Your mental health, we have so many mental health diagnoses now that I don't know which one doesn't know what he's doing or she's doing.
Yeah. Interesting. You know? I was speaking with the president of Milton Hospital not too long ago, and they're looking at integrating a mental health counselor right in the ER, right in the triage portion when you first come into the ER, to you know, deal with it right at that level.
We had a mental health. It was called the Best Team. It's in Boston, and their clinicians would come in and they'd talk to the patient and they'd talk to us, and we were trying to get them beds, or
yeah.
they would decide whether or not they needed to get into psychiatric treatment. One of them got a job working with the police, and he would go out in the police cars.
Okay.
Or if they're not ambulances or whatever, maybe
yeah.
a bigger than a police car. Fabulous. And then they turned him into a police officer, so I don't know if he's still in mental health, but he
okay.
was fabulous. And all of these guys, and it should be. Mental health is a huge issue, and it's can start very, very early, and if we don't recognize it, then it's a problem. But you can't just say, well, he has mental health issues. He's not held responsible for assault in a healthcare
right.
worker.
Have you ever been assaulted yourself, Sheila?
Oh, yes.
You have?
I have been assaulted,
okay.
and I have done the police reports, and I've gone to court.
Mm-hmm.
And some of the lawyers don't like to hear that their client got probation. So they yell at the person. That, I mean, it's really funny. But you have to go there to understand.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't talk. One of the girls was there that was assaulted. And the person that assaulted her came out from wherever he was, some holding or something. He's standing there. And he takes a look at her and he gives her a wink. And she just
kind
didn't
have... Kind of intimidating.
Oh.
Yeah.
We had to hold her down. I mean, you're in a courthouse. You can't go beat... I mean, we're stop healthcare violence. You can't beat up people.
Yeah. You know? It's. I'm sure a lot of people hearing this are hearing it for the first time. I am not. I have had a friend who has been an IV nurse in the ER at South Shore Hospital for over 28 years.
Wow.
And she's been assaulted many times.
Yes.
And tells stories very similar to yours, where she has to try and administer, put an IV into a person when they're very agitated, and she has been struck and spat upon and other things.
Yeah.
So it is an issue.
And she works by herself.
And she works by herself.
And that's... Yeah. When we were in the ER, when the IV nurses came, we would try to be there because the patient, it hurts. You know, you get a needle into the arm, and these IV nurses, they do miracles.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they get an IV that you can't even feel.
That's right. Yeah.
And so she's trying hard. She has to concentrate. She doesn't have, I mean, she has the ability, but she's so busy trying to get that IV in, she doesn't see the other hand come at her.
Right, exactly.
And we've done that. We had IV nurses, and then I guess they were moved on. We didn't need them anymore.
Yeah.
And we were doing them. And if we didn't have a second nurse right there to help us, we would get clobbered.
Tell me about the event on the 23rd, Sheila.
Oh, this is healthcare violence, and we thought maybe we could get a lot of vendors that would help with self-care. And we decided that if we had a health fair and had these vendors get more people in to take care of themselves. PTSD is out there, and it's real. And so a lot of people just don't know how to do a lot of things to take care of themselves. They're just locked up in their heads. So we have demonstrations going on. We have yoga, and we may have, I can't even say what it is. It's like a Tai Chi. And then we're going to have a demonstration for some moves to protect yourself.
Oh, okay.
And we're going to have a karate school come in and just for a little while, maybe 10, 15 minutes, perform with the little kids.
Okay.
And that would be fun. We're going to have lots of gift baskets and have drawings every half hour or every hour or something. And it's just some place that you can go and you bring in your family and you see the stuff that these vendors sell. It's organic, it's holistic. There'll be card reading. It's just going to be a fun time.
Okay.
And we're hoping that we can get the word out, change the way that people think. Let them know that we get assaulted, become change agents in our own field, and kind of say we're not going to take this assault anymore, and maybe it will work.
So you're asking healthcare workers to come, first responders,
yes,
and just the
everybody,
general public
yes,
too?
I emailed to all the ambulance people
and
sent the bill in because that's important. And to please come and support us. And they're the ones, I mean, they've had some I've treated some of these guys. They go into a home and they're running up the stairs to get somebody that might have overdosed, but they get pepper sprayed.
Mm.
And what's right with that? I mean, don't call us. Let them die if they want to overdose. But I guess I shouldn't say that on public television.
It's however you feel, Sheila, you know. Yeah.
It's just...
It's obviously very emotional.
Us.
Yeah,
it is. It's
well, as you say, one of the pieces of literature. It's not in my job description to be assaulted.
It isn't.
Yeah,
it isn't. And maybe if we read the job descriptions and if they ever put it in there, we wouldn't take the job.
Right.
You know, we're nurses and X-ray techs and phlebotomists. All we want to do is help the patient.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want to be unsafe.
StopHealthcareViolence.org is your main website to go to.
And brand new nonprofit.
Yeah, the event on the 23rd up at X1 Boston on Wood Road in Braintree.
Yes, it is.
All right. I hope folks come out and take your message to heart, and good luck with getting your legislation passed in the future.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thanks for coming by, Sheila. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Just enough time to recap the forecast for you for the rest of the day today. Really kind of the nicest day of the week today with some sun and clouds, temperatures in the mid-70s. Nice night tonight. It'll cloud up. It'll cool down to the lower 60s, and that sets the stage for the chance for showers pretty much every day this week, right through Thursday, maybe even Friday as well. Next weekend actually looks pretty good if we're looking ahead that far. But right now we have partly cloudy, 72. Thanks again to Sheila Wilson for joining us today from Stop Healthcare Violence. You're welcome. Thank you to our crew, and thank you for watching. Friday at 11:30, Shelley Dean is here from the Quincy Energy and Sustainability Department on another live edition of Currently in Quincy. We'll see you then.